Good morning, friends. Dr. Pepe speaking. Welcome to the webinar about basic chest interpretation. Today, we are going to start with the PA chest radiograph with the first part of the lecture. It's important to know that when looking at the chest radiograph initially, our first question should always be, is the chest normal or abnormal? This is very important. Because if the chest is normal, our mission is finished. If the chest is abnormal, then we have to do some investigation of the chest finding. The first step, of course, is discover the findings in the chest X-ray. The second, most of the time, not always, but most of the time, we do a cross-sectional imaging, which the majority of times is a CT. And then with that information, we make a tentative diagnosis. But what happens if we discover the finding in the chest X-ray? Then we don't do any cross-sectional imaging, and of course, no diagnosis is coming. This is very important because of about 50% of our diagnostic errors are due to missed findings, visible findings in the chest X-ray. So how can we avoid making changes, I'm sorry, how can I avoid making mistakes in the chest X-ray? Well, let's go to the first case. This is a preoperative radiograph for varices in a 60-year-old woman. This is the chest, which is apparently normal. We ask the question, is the chest normal or normal? And most of the times we are going to say normal, but it is not. There is a visible abnormality. And I'm going to ask you, where is the abnormality? Is it in the right upper quadrant? Is it in the lower quadrant, in the right, left upper, or right lower, okay? Look carefully, and if you don't see anything, I suggest that you look at the mediastinal contour. Okay, now, I suggest now that you stop the presentation, and at your home, take your time looking at the X-ray. And when you are finish, then go to the presentation again. Now we are back, and look at this. It's apparently normal, and I suggest, as I suggested now, look at the contour of the left mediastinum. See? Normal, 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 normal. And what happened when we come here? We see a small nodule overlapping the border of the cardiac silhouette. This was seen only by 9% of the contestants of the assistant in the live presentation, and this is the right answer. There is an abnormality in the left lower quadrant. You can see that better in the countdown view, and of course, initially the person that read this radiograph missed the finding and read the chest as normal. 4 years later, see, there you have a large nodule. The nodule has grown in the meantime, and the CT shows that the nodule has low density, about minus 30 Hounsfield units, and on needle biopsy happens to be a pulmonary hamartoma, which is a very good diagnosis for the patient and bad news for the radiologist who initially missed the initial nodule. How we avoid making this type of mistake? Well, we use a checklist. A checklist is a list of things that you must remember to avoid missing abnormalities. It's used in the industry, it's used in the airplane pilots, and also in medicine. And are a way of dealing with complexity. And you will agree with me that chest radiograph are very complex. So to avoid making errors, to avoid missing visible things, we had to use checklists. Everybody has his particular checklist. I have one that is working very well for me, and I have been transmitting for the last years. I divide the PHS into three areas, three zones, the upper, middle, and lower zone. The upper area starts at the top of the aortic node, the middle about more or less the middle third of the chest, and this is the middle area, and then everything under this this line is a lower area. That's how you separate the upper, middle, and lower areas. Let's go to case number two. Chest radiograph of a 73-year-old man with malaise and weight loss. Look at your chest X-ray. Apparently normal, apparently. And I ask you four questions. Where is the abnormality? Is it in the upper zone? Is it in the middle zone? Or the lower zone? Or for possibility, you cannot tell because many times you are not sure, of course. So again, my suggestion at home, stop the presentation, look carefully, take your time, and then let me know because we are not in contact, but just think about what your answer is. Okay, we're back to the presentation, and those are the answers that people in the live presentation gave. Mostly went for the lower zone because the heart is enlarged. But don't forget, if you find one thing, you have to look for other, because otherwise you will be guilty of satisfaction of search. And since we are looking about the upper zone, that's where the abnormality is. About 20%, 21% of the people answer the right answer. And the abnormality is that there is a protrusion of the right wall of the trachea. See, there's a curve there, which indicates that there is a mass pushing into the trachea. And about 90% of the time, this mass is going to be a thyroid mass, of course. But in this particular patient, coronal or axial CT show large mass not related to the thyroid, seen in the coronal and axial view, with in biopsy happens to be a lymphoma. I'm showing this case to emphasize the importance of looking at the trachea. In the upper zone, the trachea is very easily visible. Because it's outlined by air and it's always in the middle, in the midline. The tracheal semiology is also very basic. Well, you have to look at tracheal deviation and also changes in caliber. Tracheal deviation is very easily seen, of course, and we have to separate the upper from the lower trachea. Upper trachea, cervical trachea, and thoracic trachea, separated more or less at the level of the clavicle. If you have a deviation of the upper trachea, as I said before, 90% or even 95% of the time is an enlarged lobe of the thyroid, as in this case. That will be your first diagnosis, and the others are much less common. If you see the lower deviation of the lower trachea, the most common deviation is by an enlarged aortic arch, as you see in this case. Aortic arch on the left, trachea deviated towards the right. Abnormalities of the aortic arch also deviate the trachea, and that, as I said, should be your first thought when you see the trachea deviated in the thoracic space. Here we have a very normal variant, which is a right aortic arch, and the trachea is deviated towards the left. The other possibility is a mediastinal mass, as we see over here. The trachea is markedly displaced towards the right by a large mediastinal mass, which on CT is an intrathoracic goiter because it has a typical appearance, increased opacity by the iodine content in the CT. And by far, intrathoracic goiter is the most common mass. It's not the only one, of course, but it is the most common mass in the upper mediastinum, deviating the trachea, of course. Changes of caliber. Well, changes of caliber also are very, very easy. The trachea may be either narrow or widened. when we see the narrow tracheae, actually we know or the what is the diameter of the trachea, we know here is markedly narrow. This is the most common occurrence in what is called the saber sheath trachea in chronic obstructive bronchopulmonary disease. And it has a typical findings, which, you know, the cervical trachea is normal, the thoracic trachea is narrow in the PA film. You see that in the CT, narrow here, and is widened in the lateral view. As you can see, there is a marked difference in diameter, which gives it the trachea, the saber sheath appearance, which again is practically pathognomonic of chronic obstructive bronchopulmonary disease. Okay, and may help you if you had doubts looking at the chest X-ray. If you see this trachea, say it's almost 100% that the patient has COPD. Okay, the opposite is the wider trachea. And the majority of residents, when they see a widened trachea, like this one there, see in both the diameter, they always mention Monier-Kuhn syndrome, tracheobronchomegaly, which is a congenital disease with laxitude of the cartilage involving the trachea and most often the bronchi, that what is called tracheobronchomegaly. Still, in daily life, the most common cause of large trachea, the widened trachea, is either COPD or fibrosis. Pulmonary fibrosis, chronic pulmonary disease, and COPD are the most common causes of tracheomegaly in the daily practice. Okay, so widened trachea, COPD, fibrosis, or well, if you are taking examination, always mention tracheomegaly or tracheobronchomegaly or Monier-Kuhn syndrome. Good. Let's go to case number 3. Radiograph belonged to a 51-year-old man with low-grade fever and malaise. I say that if you look at this, probably you will say it's normal, but we're not talking about normal films here. So the film is abnormal, and I'm asking you where is the abnormality. Is in the lung? Is in the mediastinum? Is the chest wall? Or you are not sure, you can tell, which is a honorable answer and an honest answer. Okay, look at it, stop the presentation, and decide where the abnormality is. And then turn to the presentation when your mind is made up. Back here, where is the abnormality? The abnormality is in the mediastinum, and was answered by 63% of the assistant to the live presentation. Where is the abnormality? Where there is some widening of this area, and there is blurring of the right paratracheal line. You can see the inner part, but you cannot see the outside, and this is abnormal. Let's go and see the normal anatomy of the right paratracheal line. Right paratracheal line is the wall of the trachea, actually, and is outlined by air inside and air in the lung, of course. And then we see a perfect line that is reflected here in the chest. There, you see normal paratracheal line, not too thick, no more than 3 millimeters. And you can see the inner and the outer wall. Outside, you have the line of the superior vena cava, of course. Okay, but this will be the normal paratracheal line. Let's go back to the case. Here, you don't see the paratracheal line. You only see the inner part. You don't see the outer part. And there is also some thickening of the mediastinum, meaning that there is something in this area which is blurring the outside line or the outside wall of the paratracheal line. So this may be normal. They probably is abnormal. Anyhow, you had to do a CT to be sure there are no lymph nodes in this area, which are the most common cause of blurring or increase of the paratracheal line. The CT, coronal CT, shows you the inner wall perfectly well, shows some fat and also several lymph nodes in this area. The axial view shows the same thing, 1, 2 lymph nodes there, significant size, and see how the wall of the trachea is separated from the outside lung by the lymph node in the middle. And this is abnormal, and this is a patient with lymphoma that was discovered because the widened and obliterated right paratracheal line in the PA field. Okay, let me show you an example of just to emphasize the importance of the paratracheal line in a patient with pulmonary sarcoidosis. 2013, this patient was diagnosed of pulmonary sarcoidosis. He has some pulmonary disease in both the upper lobes and has a normal paratracheal line, right paratracheal line. Okay, the patient was not treated, don't know the reason. And 1 year later, the chest, the pulmonary disease has worsened compared to the previous one. But look at the paratracheal line. Now, it obviously enlarged. So we suspect not only that the pulmonary changes are worse, but there are lymph nodes here. We do the CT, coronary CT, numerous lymph nodes infiltrating the right paratracheal area in the mediastinum. The patient was treated with corticoid. There is 1 year later, the pulmonary disease has improved. And now again, we have a normal looking paratracheal line indicating that the lymph nodes have disappeared. Okay, that's very important because many times we overlook this finding. And I say from the diagnostic point of view, maybe very important. Let's go now to case number four, a 47-year-old man with cough and weight loss. Look at the chest X-ray that was read as normal initially. And I'm going to ask you where the abnormality is. Since we are talking about the upper zone, the abnormality is either in the right apex or the upper mediastinum, the left apex, or you cannot tell, which is a valid answer, okay? Look at it, look at this space from here up, and stop the presentation, look at the X-ray, make up your mind, and come back to the presentation. Now, back to the presentation. This is the answer. That's an excellent answer because 73% of the participants answer that the left apex, which is the normal diagnosis or the correct diagnosis. There is a difference between the right side and the left side. There is some shadow over there, probably nodule over there. I'm going to show you the countdown view. Now you see this opacity there, rounded opacity, which is suspicious. And more suspicion even because of the patient has had a chest X-ray 4 months earlier and the abnormality was here. And it's giving us important information. Both of the X-rays were read as normal, but we know that whatever is here is growing very fast because here is much smaller that 4 months later. Well, as I said, both the X-rays were read as normal, and see what happened 1 year later. There is now a very large mass occupying most of the left upper lobe in the chest X-ray and on the CT, and there is a second mass in the right lung, and both of them were diagnosed as carcinoma. This is a bilateral carcinoma that was overlooked 1 year before this examination. And the shame is that the patient went and died shortly after these X-rays were taken. So it is very important to detect nodules in the lung. Another example, another patient with the, now that we know that is there, an obvious nodule there in the first intercostal space, anterior intercostal space, again, was read as normal, it was missed. And this is 1 year later, increased size of the nodule, affectation of the rest of the lung, CT, not only the nodule is bigger, but is infiltrating the chest wall. Why I'm showing that? Because there was a study made by Austin in radiology a few years back, where he saw that about 1/4 of 50% of apical nodules are missed. We don't see them, and we don't see them because we don't look for them. If we do, we will see them. So the important, I say again, the important teaching point, when you see a normal or apparently normal chest X-ray, always look at the apices of the lung, the upper lobes, to be sure you are not looking any nodule. And see, the average size was 1.6 centimeter, which is not a small feat. Okay? A pitfall, a very common pitfall that you shouldn't confuse with a real nodule. A pseudonodule of the first costal cartilage, which calcified and give you this pseudonodule, as I told you, it shouldn't be confused with the real thing. Very easy because they look calcified, so no problem. If you happen to have any doubt, as in this case, for example, don't worry, and you can do ACT, because then you will demonstrate that the apparent nodule there is just calcification of the costal cartilage. But even simpler than that, if you have a doubtful nodule, as this one, look at the previous film. This is the cheapest way of confirming that it's not the real nodule, but the calcified cartilage, and then you can go home free. Okay? So remember, the previous film is the most useful examination that you can get in your daily practice. Now, this is a 58-year-old man with pain in the shoulder, because you had to look for other things other than nodules. This patient was seen 4 months before these X-rays was taken with the same findings and was dismissed as normal. But the second time, it was discovered that it has thickening of the pleura in the left apex compared to the Rex 1. So it has a asymmetric thickening of the apical pleural cap. This is important, especially if it is associated with clinical findings, because then you had to exclude a superior sulcus tumor. In this particular case, at this time, there you have the localized view. Again, you see better the asymmetrical thickening and some opacity here too in the apex that was not present in the other side. You are supposed to do ACT to exclude a superior sulcus tumor. And there you have a superior sulcus tumor. Obviously, the mass is over there, and not only is there, but it's also encasing the left subclavian artery. So in apical, asymmetrical apical pleural thickening with symptoms, exclude a superior sulcus tumor with ACT. If the patient is asymptomatic, the most common finding, of course, the most common diagnosis is an apical pleural cap, which occurs frequently. It's not common to be asymmetrical, but when it is asymmetrical, then think of apical pleural cap again if the patient is asymptomatic. In this particular patient, we have an obvious thickened apical pleural cap, nothing on the other side, so it could be a superior sulcus tumor. It said that in this patient has clips, surgical clips in the breast, so probably this is due to radiotherapy. We have a condom view showing the same thing better. And again, look at the previous film. We know the antecedents of radiotherapy 4 years earlier was completely completely equal. There is no difference between both of them. So now we know this is an apical pleural cap, and we had to do nothing and reassure the patient that she has nothing. Okay? Just to finish, another cause of apparently normal case. This is a preoperative chest for varices in a 54-year-old woman. If you look at it, it's apparently normal. Trachea in the midline, no nodules, but you have to look also at the periphery, at the shoulders. If you look at the shoulders, you will see that there are periarticular calcifications on the right side and also on the left side. When we take a condown view of the shoulder, you can see that the patient has a calcific tendinitis that in this particular case is bilateral. And in my experience, this is very common, not very common, but you see very often, in especially in middle-aged women and older, that they have a lot of calcific tendinitis. So something you had to look for in every chest X-ray. You had to look at the shoulders to see if you see any shoulder pathology, especially this one, because as I say, it's not unusual. Another thing I can see occasionally is this thing over here, which is visible in the condom view, acromioclavicular joint dislocation. And surprisingly enough, many times the patients don't know that they have this dislocation. They are not aware of it. Okay, just look at the shoulder in everybody, because you are going sometimes to find some surprises. Of course, you are going to find other type of abnormalities, as degenerative changes, sometimes occasional, very rare tumor, etc., etc. So we are finishing now, and let's summarize the content of the webinar. Upper area checklist, the trachea in the middle, visible in 100% of the cases. Look for caliber changes and displacement by masses. Look at the right paratracheal line, visible in significant number of cases, in more than 90%, wider than 3 millimeters is abnormal, or if the outline, the outside line is blurred, the outside contour is blurred, think of abnormality and duodenity. Pulmonary apices, search for pulmonary nodules and apical pleural thickening. And finally, look at the shoulder and look for periarticular calcifications and any possible osseous lesion. And follow Dr. Pepe's advice. This will be the advice for the webinars to come. The main role of chest radiograph is to detect abnormalities. Our most common error, which is half 50% of them, is failing to see a visible, that's important. They are visible abnormalities. So if we look for them, we are going to find them. And detecting abnormalities is improved by using checklists. So use checklists, okay? That's all. Thank you very much for your attention. And I hope you will come back to the next webinar. Thank you.